AWS, it's a cloud-based service which can give you everything at one place, you rather than in setting it up with the entire cluster. Okay, if you want to run a machine learning model, maybe you have to have a system. You should have a GPU system for neural networks. You should have Python installed. You should have the data in your machine. Everything you should have in your system. Practically going forward, this may not be possible in the real time because the data is huge. We are into the big data driven world where the data is huge and you cannot maintain that everything in your personal system. So we have a different cloud-based services, Amazon, Azure, and GCP. So as discussed, we were going through about the AWS services. Okay. Everything you have a different services. If you want to store the data, you will be storing in S3 bucket. If you want to use it for some compute method, you will go with EC2. I have a database. In my database, currently in my own system, I cannot maintain a huge database because of my system configuration. I can maintain in a cloud based. That becomes Amazon's relational database, RDS. With respect to access management, so I will be going through something called identity and access management, which is IAM. And finally, there are two or other more like services which is very much useful for machine learning, that is called SageMaker. Okay, now as we have seen, the AWS supports a lot of features with respect to the cloud based. Okay, it supports 200 products and services. Okay, and the billing is everything per hour. Okay, and it is easy process. You need not need any software or hardware. This is why I'm stressing so much. You don't need your system at all. Today you will see the live example of how can I do it, a model without accessing of any my personal softwares or hardware. Just I need an internet. Okay, so as we have seen, this is what is a portal. So this portal is basically like the console portal, and you have a lot of features. As I said, 200 services you have with respect to compute, with respect to analytics, with respect to database, with respect to gamings. You have around 200 features. Okay, in that, the first one maybe I would say is EC2. This is basically to create virtual systems. Okay, for example, your system is on Windows. Suppose I need Mac, I need Windows, I need Linux. I can easily go and get this system with the configuration, how much RAM you require, how much storage required. Everything you can create it, and the service which we use will be Elastic Compute Cloud, which is also called EC2. Okay, it's nothing but E. Two C's are there. One is for compute, one is for cloud. So they have named it as EC2. Okay, so this is something which we'll not be creating because of usage. Like, we don't need a virtual system. We need our data to be stored, and we need the model to be executed. Okay, now Amazon relational database service. So this is all we have covered, I'm giving a recap. Okay, so with respect to Amazon relational database, we have something called, if you want to maintain a database, you have to have a hardware software installed in your system. Maybe it will take some time for that. This Amazon relational database service, which is primarily known as RDS, it is actually a managed service to set up a database in the cloud. Directly you can run the query in the cloud, directly you can query it on the cloud, directly you can create the database objects. Everything you can do it at automatically you can do it in the cloud. Okay, and one thing is, since everything is in the cloud, you need not go with the backups, you need not go with the patching, you need not go with the setups, you need not go with the updates. Everything is taken care by the system. Okay, so this is about RDS. This is how it looks. Directly you can write the code and you can execute it. Suppose let us say I've run the code, select employee name, first name, last name from employees where hire date is greater than 1994 January 1st, I will be getting the result. This is how I can directly code it. And just imagine this, I'm not using in my personal system, directly I'm using in my cloud based. Okay, now this is where our problem is. This is where our problem is. To store the data, your data or your personal system is not sufficient. If the data is around 2 terabyte and your laptop is sizes of 1 terabyte, how can you store the data? There is a problem in your storing the data. Okay, when you're running the model, we have many algorithms in our machine learning and deep learning. Like we have linear regression, logistic regression, random forest, SVM, then decision tree, okay, XGBoost. We have many algorithms which has to be written code in the Python. Maybe I would say the environment is required. And finally, your system should be very good system for the compute. Let us say you have one simple calculator and let us say you have one scientific calculator. I hope everyone knows what a scientific calculator. Suppose you want to calculate some square theta, sine theta, some complex trigonometric function, log functions. You cannot do it in your simple laptop. Why? It is designed for a simple operations. Similarly, CPU systems are like designed for normal purpose. GPU systems has been designed for advanced process. If you want to work on image processing, if you want to work on deep learnings, you need a GPU system. If I want to include in a GPU system, the laptop which you are seeing on the screen, maybe this cost 1 lakh. But if I want to have a more of GPU systems, it may cost me more. I cannot keep on doing scaling. Today I need 4 GB RAM, tomorrow I need 8 GB RAM, day after tomorrow I need 16 GB RAM. This is not possible because I have to keep on scaling. At one point of time, my motherboard does not support. My increasing the RAM also may not support. So this is with respect to the problem. This is a process, but this process not practically possible in my personal system. Okay, now let's talk about the storage first. When I say that the data is not stored in a normal system, I will be going with something called S3. As a data scientist, this is something which you have to know. EC2 and all, if you don't know also, it's fine, but this is something which you have to know. This is where the data will be stored. Okay, the S3, it stands for SSS. It's basically called as Simple Storage Service. The Simple Storage Service is nothing but they have defined as S3. Okay, when you talk about S3, so object storing built, like object storage is used to build and retrieve any amount of data. That means you can store data in this bucket. You can use it as your storage device. Let me put it in simple way. Suppose your system is 1 terabyte. Okay, you want to store 2 terabyte. What you will do? Once 1 terabyte is your personal system configuration, another 1 TB you have to store. What you will do? You will buy one hard disk. In the hard disk, you will maintain one terabyte. In your personal system, you will maintain 1 terabyte. And you will be using this for your analysis applications. Similarly, if the data is something which has to be stored, this is a service they will be using. And this services is like simple storage service. Okay, so this is a simple storage service which offers like a lot of securities. And it will be like a scalable at a low cost. When you compare everything, I would say that this is the best one. Okay, so let me give one more example. You want to store the data. Okay, you will purchase pen drive or you'll purchase hard disk. Let me be clear. I will tell you about the cost as well. For one terabyte, okay, maybe let's talk in GBs. Okay, for one GB, okay, you need one GB pen drive. Okay, for 100 GBs, you need 100 pen drives. Okay, if it is 1 GB capacity, if it is 2 GB capacity, you still need 50 pen drives. If it is 3 GB capacity, still you need 33 pen drives. Will you go for this, or at a stretch I will buy one hard disk of 1 terabyte? Obviously the second one is the best one. Rather than taking 50 hard disk devices, I will take one. So the capacity of pen drive is that much only. The capacity of hard disk is this much. So obviously I'll go with a huge space. So this type of, when you compare all other storage, this is actually the low cost. And the last one is a special feature. It can store any type of data you want. Okay, and read it many a times, there will be no problem at all. Okay, so this is a simple storage service which is pretty much we'll be using in our data science storage models. Okay, now this IAM is basically related to the admin part. Like, for example, you go to a system, like you go to a company, you go to an organization, everyone cannot access every data. Okay, so I will talk about the buckets. Okay, if I'll talk about the buckets in terms of bucketing, bucket in the sense it's like a within the S3 bucket which will store the data. So as an end user, like as a working employee, you will not be given access to all the buckets. They may give only development database, they may give only UAT database, they may not give you production database. Okay, since you're all working at a client side, like we are all working in India and we are all working for US clients, clients may not give every access to us. Sometimes they may restrict certain access, and those things is being given from this identity and access management, which is basically allows users to access you securely. It is actually a very good service which is used to create the users and or access or deny. For example, you join a project, they will give you access. Suppose you don't join a project, you are like released from the project, they will deny your access. So this type of access related informations is coming from the identity and access management, which is also called as IAM. Okay, so this is with respect to IAM. Now we will see what exactly is our problem. I hope at least everyone knows at least one machine learning problem. Okay, one machine learning. So what exactly is doing is, for you, let me tell you what you have done so far. Okay, in your classes, maybe you loaded the CSV file. Maybe you have written import pandas import numpy data equal to pd.read.csv read excel. Then pd.shape, pd.missingvalues, pd.groupby, train and data, everything you have done it. Okay, but what is the problem? For now, everything is going good, but in the real time, building, training, deploying machine learning problems is not easy. Why it's not easy? Because the data will be huge, the computational power requires huge, each and every one system will not be unique. I may have 1 terabyte, you may have 50 GB. I may have 16 GB RAM, you may have 8 GB RAM. In my system, the model will work. In your system, the model will not work. You cannot store it in your personal systems. That's why we are maintaining a cloud-based virtual systems in order to run it. Now there is a problem. Okay, now, before I even go with this, let me explain one model. Okay, so try to understand and again relate everything with a simple model. Okay, now let us say there is a first one we are going to see is, okay, we are going to see about linear regression, but before that I need to know What is a problem statement? What is a solution? What is a linear regression which we are going to do? And we'll see about the data and the model. This one I'm explaining the first model, okay? Let us talk about the use case. Let us say you go and start working with a company as a data scientist in X company. Okay, the company which you go, the HR work is very, very hectic work. The HR work is very, very hectic work. This is all HR's work. Let's see what is that. First of all, HR is busy filtering out candidates for requirements. Yes. HR is the person who is scheduling the interviews. Yes. Most of you would have attended few interviews. You know who is going to call you. Directly a project manager will not call you. Directly one who is working in the organization will not call you. The person who will call you will be HR. And one, okay, let me tell you flow. Let us say this is a person who is applying for the jobs. Okay, he gets one call from HR. This person, HR, what he does, he schedules a meeting with a technical person. Technical person will clear either pass or fail, or maybe like cleared or not cleared. Okay, selected or rejected, something you will tell. Once this is cleared, once this is selected, this will again go back to the HR, the role, like the process. Again, there is a salary discussion happening from the HR. Technical person will not ask what is the salary. Technical person will not ask what you are going to join. But again, if it is pass, only then it will go to the HR. If it is failed, some HRs, if they are good, they'll call and tell that you have not cleared. Or else they will not even go. They will just not pick your calls. So this is the process. Don't you think HR work is too much? They have to filter it out. They have to schedule the interviews. And also they have to discuss about the package. And if you see, there could be hundreds of employees and there could be only two HRs. How do you manage this? Even there are all human beings. Even they have to work only for 8 hours. There is a problem here. The company which I went as working as a data scientist, I am facing this problem. Now what to do? Now among this, what is the something which I will say it's a very, very challenging step is this one. Having one-to-one meeting with each candidate to discuss the salary is the most time-consuming activity of the hiring process. Filtering out, basically they'll filter out with respect to the system. They'll go to Naukri, they will search it. Scheduling it, they will just have some juniors or they themselves can open Google Meet, Zoom meeting, Teams meeting, they can go and schedule. But what is the most challenging is to make them understand the company requirements and their expectations and to match it. So it will go on extending because I may ask 5 lakhs, she may tell not 4 lakhs is a fine. Then I have to again compromise like 4.25. She will again come back with 4.5. So something, there will be long discussion and the most challenging step is this one. Okay, now. What happens in this company X is when I went to the data scientist, I was facing these issues. Hey, what is this? HR is always busy. She's not even picking my call. When I go and research it, she was also stuck with a lot of problems like hiring, discussing, one-to-one meeting, decision making, and also package discussion. This is where the HR was stuck up with. Now, as a data scientist to my current new company, what suggestions I can give are to make her work easier. Now what I think is, I try to automate this process. Okay, so on what basis they decide the salary? For example, your 3 years experience, you make 6 lakhs. You may 4 years experience, you may like expect 8 lakhs experience. You may be 5, maybe they'll expect 10 lakhs. So this is a standard. Okay, say suppose a 6 years person who has taken an interview and HR is having, she may ask 12. That guy may ask 12. But HR says, no, no, as per organization, maybe we'll give only 11.5. Again, that guy will like they will like a bargain, like he'll tell that no, no, I have the skills, I have to work, it's my current hikes plus 30% hike. Something this exactly this is actually going more than 30 minutes. This is the most challenging time in my project. So what I will do is I will just try to automate this. Okay, and how do you solve this problem? Okay, now we have understood the problem. We'll go to the solution. Before that, is the problem clear? Everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now, son, we have seen the problem. We'll see what is the solution. Okay, let's go back to the solution. So, how are you going to automate this process? This is the first step. First of all, you try to understand the data. When I say if I want to try to understand the data, the things which you have to keep in mind is what is a pattern? When I say pattern, 2 years experience, what is the total salary is getting? 4 years experience, what is getting? 6 years experience, what is getting? That data I need. Last week, like last class, I told a very good example. If I'm showing you a cat or a dog of a different breed, you will still tell correctly. Wow. From the beginning of your age, like from the beginning of your childhood days, you are seeing n number of dogs, you are seeing n number of cats, easily you will tell. That input which you're seeing as acts like a data inputs pattern. What pattern will the cat look? What pattern will the dog look? Dogs are big in size. Cats are small in size. Cat's face is round. Dog's face will be long. So those type of data points and patterns you have understood. The same concept I'm trying to bring here. Try to understand the pattern. Okay. So this is experience. This is salary. 2 years experience. 4 years salary, 3 years experience, 6 years, 6 lakhs pack, 6 lakhs is a salary. 4 years, 8 lakhs. 5 years, 10 lakhs. Now I'll ask you the difference, the relation between X and Y. Can anyone tell what is the relation?
Linear relationship.
No, I'm not asking linearity. What you're seeing in the data, how experience is related to salary?
Experience is double this.
Yes, experience is 2 times the salary. If your experience is 2, 2 into 2, 4. If your experience is 3, 2 into 3, 6. So it's basically 2x. 2x, this is a relationship that you know. Okay, but in an organization, if the data is huge, like you have something like for 2 years you may get 3.5, for 3 you may get somewhere around 9.5. So it will, based on the all the data set, it will find the relationship X and Y. Okay, so this linear regression, what we have to understand is now the linear regression is a linear approach to the modeling. The relation between the dependent variable and independent variable. Here, the salary is dependent variable. The salary is dependent. Experience, anyone can be with any experience. You don't have control. Suppose if some person is coming, okay, I cannot tell that, hey, you have to have only 2 years experience. No. It is what is this experience that only matters here. So what happens in the real time is experience is independent, salary is dependent. Try to understand what is dependent and independent. Then maybe the linear regression, I would say one independent and one dependent is something which we have in our data. and we also want to find the relationship between X and Y. This is our objective, to find a relationship. Okay, now how to take forward a very, very simple mathematics which we have already learned in our school, Y is equal to MX plus C. Okay, so you plot a linear line between X and Y and you find the best fit line. And once you find the best fit line, you are going to get the dependent variable, the independent variable, and M will be the slope and C will be the constant, which is an intercept. This will give the relationship between X and Y. You are telling it is 2X. The same thing it will be applied to this equation. Maybe what is the intercept, what is the slope, everything they will calculate. This I hope everyone knows linear regression. Okay, now this is a relation I want to find, and my objective is always to find what is C, what is M. If you substitute those two, then X and Y you will automatically get it from the data set. So this X and Y, which is something which I directly get from the data set, and M and C is something which I have to calculate. If I calculate this, I will get to know how much X is related to Y. This is about this. Okay. Now I'll show a simple model. Okay. I'll show a simple model. Let us say this is a model. This is a model. Okay. And this model has 30 rows, 2 features. Okay, 30 rows and 2 features. When I go and run data.head, this is what the data is. For 1.1 year experience, that in that organization, the HR is giving 39,000. In 1.3 years experience, they're giving 46,000. 2 years experience, they are giving 43,000. It's all coming from month-wise salary. Suppose you get your 4 years experience, monthly you will get 55,000. Suppose your 6 years experience, you'll get 90,000. 6.8, 91,000. 8.2, 1,30,000, and 10 years is a maximum years which are there in this organization. That is experience. The maximum experience in this organization is 10 years, and for 10 years easily you will get 1,22,000 per month. This is a data. Now what I will do, I will see a describe, just a statistical function. What is a count? What is a minimum? Like, see, for example, this is a minimum salary, 37,000. This is a maximum salary which this guy is getting. Which is a minimum salary? This person only. No, this person. 37,000. That's what I'm getting here. So it's a simple statistical terms. Now what I'll do, I'll just check if the data is having missing values or not. All these commands I hope you understand, and it is already been covered. Data.isNullOfSum. This will give you the missing value count. Okay, then check the data type. Data types, columns, everything. So years and experiences, salary is my columns. Now what I will do, I will divide this into X and Y. I will divide the X and Y. Okay, if I want to do it, I need to give this as X and Y. And why this is not Y and X? Because this is independent, this is dependent, and that's the reason. Years of experience I'm putting into Y. So years of experience I'm putting into X, and salary I'm putting into Y. Okay, now if I run this, X will have only the year of experience. Okay. Y will have only the salary. So this one I have divided, X of experience I have put into X, salary I have put into Y. Now I have done this. Now what I will do, I'll just check if what is the years of experience of less than 5. Some conditions and all I'll check. salary should be 15,000 to 10,000. Like, is there anything else I'm doing? So those type of things I'm doing. Okay, it's just a simple querying part. Now what I have to do is, now it's my objective. It's my objective to split the data into training and test. So what I will do, train, text, white ring, white test, everything I'll divide it with is using the function called train test split, and I will be achieving a 0.2 as a percentage. That means 80% will go to train, 20% will go to test. Okay, now I run this. Okay, again I'm printing. See, 30 records were there, right? 24 went with train, 6 went with test. Okay, so this is about splitting. Now comes our model building. Only 4 lines model. Any model you take, it will not take more than 10 lines. Okay, so here I'm taking a model. The model is, I'm taking the linear regression and I'm fitting it on X train and Y train. Okay, X train and Y train, and I'm taking a fit and I'm scoring. And if I see here, I am getting this type of model. Okay, can anyone tell me whether this model is good model or not?
Not a good model.
Sorry?
Not a good model.
Why?
Test score is 0.25.
Your voice is very low.
Sorry?
Your voice is very low. I'm thinking you are speaking. Yeah.
So it is
52%
test score.
No problem, right? I have 95% in my training.
Okay, sorry.
For training, we are getting high accuracy. For test, we are getting high accuracy.
52%.
Yeah, for training, I'm getting 95% accuracy, which is a very good model. For test, I'm getting 0.5, which is not a good model. Maybe will you consider this or not? 95% is a too good model.
But it is not working on test.
Sorry?
It is not working on test data.
It is not working on test data, but test data also I've got it. It's your objective is always to compare test and score. Now I've got 0.52. Will you recommend this model to the production with respect to the client, telling that forget about the train, forget about the test, my train is giving too good model, will you consider this or not?
No.
Why?
For test data also we need to get more accuracy.
Okay, I'm expecting one word from you and no one is telling that. What type of problem is this?
Overfitting.
What is overfitting?
For train data, we are getting high accuracy. For test data, we are not getting that accuracy. Model is able to predict for train data and model is not able to predict for test data.
Yes, very good, very good. The model is overfitted model. At any point of time, you cannot consider this model to the production. While training, it is training very well. It is giving 0.95. But when you're testing on a test data, remember, test data will be unseen data or a new data. Tomorrow, any new person comes, your prediction may go wrong because the prediction percentage is just 0.5. Only 0.5 times it may be correct. Rest of the times it may go wrong. Okay, so this model is an overfitted model. Okay, how to improve this? Maybe you will going with feature engineering, missing values, outlay treatment, transformation, scaling, everything you'll do and you will make it better. Okay, so that's not our scope. Our scope is to deploy the model in the production. Okay, that is what we are going to see. Now this is a model. Okay, now if you see here, R square is also too good. R-score is not too good. Let me rerun again. Model intercept, model coefficient, model dot predict, test score. Yeah, for the training score, it is 0.52. This is what it here also I got. it's fine. Okay, now I will plot one. I'll plot one, the line. Okay, this is a regression line which I'm building. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to give this model to my HR. This linear regression model, I'm going to give it to my HR. Okay, so tomorrow, if HR wants to run this model, she will just run this. She will just run this model.predict. So let us say there is a person who joined with 7 years experience. She will just run this. For 7 years, the expected salary will be 90,000. No more discussions. 30 minutes, no more arguing, no more discussing about what package you want. This model will give an automated salary discussion based on his experience. Suppose tomorrow a person who joins with 5 years experience, and the HR need not go and check in their database for 5 years experience how much salary I have given. Like she will not go here. She will not go here and say how much I have given for five. Okay, I'm given this much. 5.3 I have given this much. So what is the range? Okay, I have to calculate in between this. If for example 5.2 comes means 5.2 means it should be in between 60,000 and 80,000. This type of things, who will do in the real time? This is where the time is getting lost. And that is the reason you are being a data scientist, trying to automate it. And I've built a linear regression model. And the final predict, if for example, 5.2, I may give 74,000, which is between 60 and 80,000. Right? This is a salary I can give if the person is 5.2 years experience. 5.1 was 65,000. 5.3 was 80,000. So obviously 5.2 will be between that, and this is a salary HR will be offering to the candidate without even discussing. Nowadays, most of the organizations are like skipping the HR rounds. They just give one form. They just ask them to fill what is their expectations, what is their experience. Based on that, automatically they are giving. Okay, so this is a simple model which I will be building and I will be giving to my HR. And if tomorrow someone who comes a 10 years experience, this is a salary that will be giving. For 10 years, 1,20,000. So already there is a person with 10 years who is getting around 1,20,000 only. The same salary you will give for the other person who is joining as a CEO, CFO, admin, senior manager, whoever it is. Based on this only, they will give the salary. And you are not going to calculate manually. The system will calculate. That is the reason you have built a linear regression model. Is it clear? Is this the model and the solution and whatever I'm going to give the HR is clear?
Yes. Clear.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now what I will do? Do you think HR will have Jupyter Notebook in a system? Do you think HR will have Anaconda in a system? Do you think HR will understand Python code in order to run this?
No,
sir.
This has to be on the UI. So in any project, okay, if there is a data scientist, they will be a web application developer, they will be a tester, they will be a Power BI developer, they will be a SQL developer, there will be a manager, they will be a data architect. So it's a team. Okay, it's a team. In my team, I may be the data scientist. I am a junior who are working on reports, who are working on SQL. So a project will be a combination of different roles. Okay, don't ever assume that in your organization. Okay, suppose let us say you go and work in an organization where there are 8 members. Don't come an impression that all 8 will be data scientists. It will never happen. all 8 data scientists will not be there in a project. Maybe you'll be having one data scientist, one Power BI developer, one SQL developer, one manager, one client. They will be having this many roles. Okay, so instead there will be a one more web application developer, web developer. This guy will make sure this is been put in a proper UI. When I say it's like a proper UI, this person will actually create one website. In that website, enter the experience of a person. So based on that experience of a person, the model will calculate, or the UI screen will pop up a message telling that this is the salary you have to give it to your employee. Okay, so this type of web application is also involved in a data science project. You don't think that, okay, always, okay, my job is done. Your job is done till the line number 59, until you make sure it is available. Then you give this code to the web application developer. They will take care. Okay, they will take care in building the model. Now, the problem is, HR problem is solved. But let me tell you what's the problem. This data is residing in my system. Agree? This Python file is residing in my system, Jupyter Notebook. See, my Jupyter Notebook is available. It's running. My Jupyter Notebook is available. I am writing the code. The data which is coming from my system, D drive. D drive is my data. So the Python file is also my file. My data is also my data. And also I would say the entire code is also running in my system. This is acceptable. What in the case of real time? Do you think this is just 30 records here? 30 rows and 2 columns. What if my data is having 30 lakh records and 25 features? What you'll do? Still, can you go and build like this? No. That is where we thought of going into AWS. Okay. Since now we have seen this problem. We have built a linear regression. Okay. So what I will do now? This is a simple model which we have built, and this is a final result. Your client may be seeing, okay, your HR may be running it, but whatever model I built, everything I built in my system. Okay. Now we'll go back to this. Now, till now it was not a problem, but now since the data is huge, preparing the data, building the data, managing it, deploying it is a real-time challenge in the environment. As I told, the test and train score is coming very less. What you have to do? It's an overfitter model. You have to go and apply transformation, scaling, feature engineering, feature extraction, ED analysis, statistics. Most of the things you will be doing, it all requires computational power. Your system should be good. RAM should be good. Your execution speed should be good. Your internet should be good. Everything has to be good in order to go with this type of model building. But I cannot expect. See, if you're all in my project, okay, I have to make sure that everyone is having a same system. One cannot have 1 GB RAM, one cannot have 2 GB RAM, one cannot have 4 GB RAM. One model will work in one system, the other model will not work in another system. This type of things I don't want. So deployment is always hard. Because of the system things, the data is huge, computational power, all these things, it needs an external support. That is where we are going and working with cloud-based model. Okay, if this slide is clear, Now we are going to work with something called AWS SageMaker. Now AWS SageMaker is a fully managed service that provides every developer and data scientist to build, train, deploy models directly in the cloud without using your personal softwares or hardwares with respect to your system. Okay, everyone, see, as a data scientist, right, you have to give suggestions. Rather than giving suggestions, if you're still working with pandas, import, numpy, data load, statistics, who will give the suggestion? At end of the day, you have to have a better solution. At end of the day, you have to have a better things to communicate to the client. You do not waste your time. SageMaker was launched just 3 years back in 2018 early, which came into production. So that is where people started using SageMaker. So SageMaker is one of the beautiful service you can see in AWS, where you can go and deploy any models, okay, without using your personal configuration Jupyter notebooks. Directly you can run the cloud on the cloud-based service. They are providing all the libraries, they are providing everything for you. You need not do anything. Okay, so this is about SageMaker. Building, training, tuning, deployment, everything you do it on the cloud. You're doing it in a system, you need a GPU system. My system is a GPU system. Okay, my system is a GPU system. It is like it cost around 1.2 lakhs, but still it will take time for tuning it. If I want to build any neural network, my system has to be running for more than 8 hours. Night I will run the model and I will leave it. Morning it will get trained. Even for the very good GPU system, it is still taking 8 hours. 8 hours, what is the power? And if it is running in GPU, the system gets heat faster. You should have an extra fan in your CPU. All those things you have to take care, right? And what will happen if I have observed this, okay? I had one more system, okay, where I was deploying neural networks. The laptop has a automatic trigger. Whenever it is exceeding overheated, the system will off. The laptop is having an external trigger. Whenever your system is getting overheated, without even asking you, it will shut down. Have you experienced this? No one is listening. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Please respond. How will I know that you are listening or not? I am asking, if your system is running continuously for 8 to 10 hours, if it is getting overheated, automatically it will get switched off. Do you agree with this or not?
Yes,
Right. So what happened in the previous days, when I using my system, 8 hours, 9 hours, I'm training a model. At the 9th hour, when the system gets overheated, it switch off. It restarts the system. It shutdowns the system. Everything, whatever the model got trained, every model, everything is gone. Again, I have to retrain it. This type of problems has occurred. What I did, I attached one extra fan, showing that it should not be heated. You have every system, every laptop has an internal built-in fan. This fan is to cooling the, we call it as a cooling pad, we call it as a cooling drain. So this is basically to cool down the CPU heatness. Okay, even after doing that also, it was a problem. So those type of problems, you no need in AWS. The system will take care. The configurations will be taken care. The GPU will be taken care. Your deployment will be taken care. Okay, so this is about SageMaker. And we have one thing like SageMaker Studio. For just example, where is the tool you will work? If I say SQL, you can work in command prompt. as well as you can work in a tool, MySQL as a tool. So something, an environment will be there. So SageMaker Studio is like a, it's like a IDE machine. Like Anaconda is there, PyCharm is there, or you have IntelliJ is there. So all these are IDE where you write the code. Okay, you can go and write every code in this studio, which is called SageMaker Studio. Very, very useful tool for building our applications in the cloud-based service. Okay, now this is about SageMaker Studio. Now what we will do, we will go and deploy it. We will go and use one. We'll go and see some practical part, how to write the code in AWS services. Okay, so let's go and debug some of the services in AWS. So this is my AWS service. Okay, so again, I'm telling okay, so I've created one snapshot of how to create an account in AWS. Okay, again, I'm telling it's completely at your risk if you want to create an account. Okay, because it is telling free, but most of the services are not free. It may be chargeable. Okay, you will not believe, when I was learning AWS some 2 to 3 years back, I have nearly lost 30 to 40,000 because I don't know how to use it. Something, I'll keep running it and it will be charging. Please make sure you keep this in mind. Something, if you start running it, if you don't stop it, every second there will be a billing happening at the back end. Okay, there are situations where even I have lost money. So always be careful. If you want to create an account, if you want to practice it, you reach out to me. I will give you some suggestions how you have to use, what you have to use. If you don't follow that, there is high likely chance there will be a lot of billing with respect to your credit card and or debit card. 2 to 3 days, if the service is running, you may lose money. Always have a good practice of stopping it when you're not using it. If you're just, see, for me, right, I don't have patience to shut down my system also. See now, even now, how many applications is opened? How many applications opened? Many things. It's a Power BI open, there's a Tableau open, there's a Jupyter Notebook open. So there is a PPT, there is a Teams. There are so many things is open, I don't shut down. The same habit if you do in cloud services, it's gone. Every second they will bill you. Okay, maybe it's very useful, but remember that if you don't use it effectively, you may lose money. With respect to organization will take care. Whether you use, you don't use, organization will pay. Organization and Amazon Web Service will be linked. They'll be tied up. They may get some discounts. Those things and all they will do. But from your end, you have to always keep a track of what is happening at the back end. Okay, so this is a free tier account which I've created. First, you have to give your email password. Okay, it will ask you the full name, phone number. Just give city, state, postal code. It's a 5-step installation. So just go with the 5-step registration. Go with the second step. Third step is where they'll ask your phone number. Enter your phone number and it will get some verification code. Accept that. And you go for the basic support plan. You can use this or you can use this for business support. So usually clients will like in the organization, they will take this $100 per month. Okay. What is $100?
$7,500.
Okay. So 7,500 is something which you take per month. You can use some AWS services, 24/7 support, everything. But I've selected the basic plan. I've completed the sign up. So if you complete the sign up, it will tell the congratulations, you have signed up for AWS. We are activating your account. Okay. So now you see, now I'll be getting in this. This is where I will be logging in as a console. Okay. So that's all. Registration is done. If the registration is done, it will show like this, AWS Management Console. That's what I am here. Okay. This is what AWS console. So I have the account now. We have a KSR AWS account. Now, if you go and see billing, okay, it's zero. Nothing I've used so far. Just now, morning, I created an account. Nothing is there. Okay, nothing is there. Sometimes, if it is exceeding this, this cost may be huge. This cost may be huge. Okay. There could be a situation where it can even go in thousands and lakhs also. Just go and see some Quora. In Quora, they would have posed questions. Without even using, I got 1 lakh in my personal laptop or a personal credit card. How it is possible? Then they go and debug it. You will see that you are running the applications without stopping it. So that's the reason it is something like it has costed. Okay, so always keep this in mind before creating. It's completely your risk. If you want to practice it, you reach out to me. I will explain how to do it. But in the real time, organization will give you the account. This is how you have to create a new account. I'll share you this document. Okay, now let's come back to this. These are the services. If you want to compute it, EC2, Lambda, Batch, AWS, Outpost, all these are there. For machine learning, you have a SageMaker, which you have just seen. We have an augmented AI, DevOps Guru, Forecast, okay, Kendla, Deep Learning, Deep Compuser. All these are services which we are using. Okay. Now, what I am going to do, I am going to first see about the storage. You have different type of storages where you can store the data. One is S3, one is EPS, one is FX, one is S3 Glacier, Storage Gateway, AWS Gateway, Backup. When I say this, if I ask you the storage devices, you may be telling pen drive, you may be telling memory card, you may be telling SSD, you may be telling hard disk, you may tell a laptop. Similarly, these are all the storage devices. Okay. So these are all storage devices. So what I will do, I will go and click S3. I will go and create S3. So Amazon S3, we already know it's a simple storage service which can keep your data safe. Now what I will do, in this S3 bucket, let me go and create my own bucket first. Let me go and create my own bucket. Again and again, I'm telling this Jupyter notebook. Okay, is I will see this Jupyter notebook. This Jupyter notebook, I will close it now. This is my local, which I close. Now I'm having only S3 bucket, which is open. It is an online, which I'm portaling. Nothing I'm using. My personal system is something I'm not using. I'm using only my internet. Using internet only, I've logged into this S3. Now I'll create my own bucket. Let us say KSR training AWS. This is a bucket name. Which region the server is available? Block all public access. Bucket versioning. Everything is fine. Okay. Now what I will do, I will go and create a bucket. Let me create it again. I'll delete this. Okay, I'll go and create it again. Create bucket. Bucket name I'll give SR training AWS region, choose bucket is fine. This is fine. Let me go for this enable advanced settings. I will give enable. Disable is there. Server side encryption. Okay, everything is fine. Okay, let me go and choose bucket. So I don't have any choose bucket. So obviously I have to go and create a new one only. So again, it'll training AWS. So nothing I'll change. I will go and create a bucket. Okay, there is one bucket that is created. When it is created, August 8, 2021, 9-8, which is in USD, UTS time. Okay. Now I will open this bucket. Okay. I can upload my data. Okay. Once I click the upload, it is asking either you want to add a folder or you want to add a file. Let me go and add file. So this is my personal data. Santosh data folder. If you see, this is my personal system. In the system, I maintain a data where every data I have maintained, I will go and load some car data, which we are very much aware of it. Okay. So I will create the car data. This car data, I will see where it is exactly. Okay. This is destination permission. Okay. So let me give everyone is accessible to this. So let me go and upload successful. Okay, now if you see this car data, this car data has been already there. Okay, now what I will do, this car data, okay, so let me see how can I access it within the cloud from my local system. I uploaded the car data. This car data, let me see how can I access through the web only. Okay, so now what I will do, permission will see everyone can access it. Okay, who can access my data? Object owner, it's my, me only can access KSR. Everyone in the public, those people also can access it. Authenticated users. Suppose you have an AWS account, even you can access it. Suppose if I don't want other people to access, I can go and give edit permission. So for this, I can read and write everything I can do. Okay. Suppose you want a new grant, like you can add it. Suppose you want everyone's to be accessing, read and write everything, I can do this. This is with respect to accessing the data. So the data is residing on this bucket. Okay, I will copy this URL and I will put it here. So in the S3 bucket, in my KSR training AWS bucket, this is a bucket name, I have uploaded the file. This is my car data which I uploaded. Is everyone clear till now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. Yes.
Now what I will do, in the same S3 bucket, I have already created one KSR training bucket. In this bucket, I can even upload few more data set. Upload. See, uploading total estimates. It is taking this much time and uploaded successful. Okay. Now you see here. Succeeded. This is all size. One is a CSV file, one is a XLS file, one is a CSV file, one is a XLS file. Okay. Now still I'm telling this data is in my cloud. Okay, it's in my cloud, it's nowhere in my system. From my system, I uploaded to the cloud. Now what I will do, what I will do? Now I will go to something called AWS SageMaker. You can even go from here. Services, where is SageMaker? Machine learning. Machine learning, I have a SageMaker. So click the SageMaker. So if you click the SageMaker, it will give the complete description of the SageMaker. Like Amazon SageMaker, build, train, and deploy machine learning models at scale. The quickest and easiest way to get the ML models from the idea to the production. You can label it, you can train it, everything you can do. Now what I will do, I will go and create a, see, I'm closing my Jupyter notebook. This is my personal laptop's Jupyter notebook, which I close it. Okay, so I don't have Python, I don't have Anaconda, I don't have Jupyter that is opened in my personal system. Now in the AWS SageMaker, I will go and initialize one notebook. That notebook, if I open, okay, there is something called create notebook instance. You click that create notebook instance. If you create the notebook instance, it is going to ask the notebook name. So let me tell KSR training notebook. Notebook name. Okay. So usually when you open your Jupyter notebook, you give your notebook name, right? That one I'm giving. And this is where you can have machine learning, or it is like machines with respect to large, medium, extra large, XL. The more wider you go, the price will be too much. For example, this requires 2 GB RAM. This requires 4 GB RAM. This requires 6 GB RAM. It's basically which type of instance you need it. If you go for the small one, it's cost effective. But for building a ML problem, which is complex, deep learning and all, you need to go for the huge one. Stick 16 GB RAM and all you have to give. Okay. Just for the purpose of showing, I'll go for this because I said everything is a cost effective. Okay, you have to spend some money if you're working on a cloud-based. So I'll go with the simple one because I'm going to work only on the simple car data. Okay, but if I'm working on any of the huge image processing, then I have to go with large one. So this is done. And with respect to permissions, okay, let me have one permission that will be like whoever can access my notebook. That permission I can give. This is all optionals, network, Git repository, tags, everything is optional. I will create the notebook instance now. Your notebook instance is being created. Open the notebook instance when the state is in service and open a template notebook to get started. It's in pending state. Now it will take some time. Okay. So I'll reload it. Still it's in pending. Again and again, I'm repeating, none of my personal things I'm opening. Everything I'm opening in the cloud only. I've uploaded the data. S3 bucket. I have so much data. Everything is in cloud. Okay, I will delete it few because it may cost me more. So I'll keep only one and I'll delete everything. All this I will delete. I showed you how to load it, but I will delete it. Okay, I will show you only if there is one data now. Only car data is there, okay, so that it will be cost less. Okay, now I have the car data. Now I'll see the instance. Still it's in pending. Bear with me for 2 more minutes. It will take some time because it's creating on the cloud. You need not install Anaconda, you need not install Python, you need not install anything. Directly it will go and create it. In the Amazon SageMaker, I have the notebook which I created my notebook instances. Okay. Still it's in pending only. We'll see. Yeah, it's in service now. Okay, so it's running. The service is running. That means I did not install a Python, I did not install a Jupyter notebook, I did not do anything. Everything is ready for me. Now there is one service which has been created, which is a notebook instance. Now I can directly open a Jupyter notebook. So if I open a Jupyter notebook, it will open this Jupyter notebook. We are redirecting to the notebook for the instance, and I have a Jupyter notebook. Again, I'm telling, if you have, I'll open it and I'll show. Okay, if I open my Jupyter notebook at my system, this is, suppose if I open any Python file, please see that it is my local host. Please see that it is my local host. That means this is in my local host. That means it's my system's Jupyter notebook. It is some sort of local host. But now what I opened is, this is KSR training notebook dot notebook US East SageMakers AWS. This has been created on the cloud, but I need not install Python, Jupyter, no Anaconda, nothing. Directly I've created in my AWS. Okay. Now what I will do, I will go and create a new file. So I have many things. I have PyTorch, I have TensorFlow, everything. It's all costly. Let me go with a simple one, conda.python. So this environment, I will create one new notebook. Again, I'm telling, which you're seeing on the screen, it's in notebook in the cloud. Okay, see here. AWS SageMakers notebook. Okay, now I'll go and run the code. Okay, now I will load the data. Can you tell me how to load the CSV file?
pd.read_csv.
pd.read.csv. Okay, so here I have to give the path. Now, usually what I used to do in my local, I used to load the data from my own data set. Like this were my data set, I used to give the path d and colon data. But now what I'm doing, I want to read the data from the S3 bucket. So this is a S3 bucket. If you go and see, there's something called copy S3 URL. If you copy it and you go and see, this is where my data is there now. In S3 bucket, in KSR training AWS bucket, this is a car data. Directly I can go and give here. Now the data is also there in my S3 bucket. Jupyter notebook is also there in my AWS SageMaker. Now you run it. The data is reading from S3 bucket and the instance is created on the AWS. It's running. It's run. Okay. Now I'll go and run aws.data.shape, data.read, data.add. See here, the data is coming here. Now you can build a model on the cloud, right? Whatever I built a linear regression model, I can build it on a AWS SageMaker without using my personal instance Jupyter notebook, without using my personal hardware for the data. Data is stored in S3 bucket, model I'm building in my AWS SageMaker. Now I can easily implement it. Nowhere my personal system is used. this is a SageMaker. This is a home button, which is again in the SageMaker. This is a notebook instance, notebook name. This is a console, whatever the data I've loaded. Maybe I'll close this. And this is a S3 buckets data. Within this bucket, there's only one data. That data I've loaded directly by giving the S3 bucket access, not my personal systems. Now you know how to build a model. You know what to do ED analysis, how to do transformations, how to do scaling. There's already EDA project been covered. You know how to do EDA. You know how to build a model. You know which is a classification problem or it's a regression problem, and you know how to do, but everything you'll do it on a cloud-based instance. Okay. Is it clear? Is it clear? In the real time, you will be building in this type of notebook, not from your personal system, but from the Jupyter instance created on the cloud-based SageMaker. Any questions? Every second it will cost me. Okay, so let me stop it. I will stop it, or else this service, right, for 5 minutes also it will cost. So let me stop it. If I stop it, maybe the server will stop. It will not work. So let me, it's stopping actually. Or else the bill will come. So let me stop it. But I've told you how to create an instance, how to select the systems which we want, and how to load it. See, this is now it's not loading the notebook. Why? I've closed the server. So it's not loading. Okay. Now I'll see. It is still in the stopping. It should completely be stopped. Okay, it will take some time. Okay, any questions?
No, sir. Sir, can we see how much it costs?
How much?
How much bill?
How much bill we will not get to know now. It usually happens, the billing happens at month level. Okay, it happens at month level. So it based on the usage. So every month I create it. And we see how much it is going. It usually goes to 3,000-4,000 for one instance. If you're just using it for 5-10 minutes also, it will go up to 3,000 to 5,000, depends on the usage. But again, depends on the data which you load, depends on the other things also. So like how much data, how much instance you are creating, everything, it will matter. Okay, so that on all things you have to keep in mind. See, this is stopped now, so I'll delete it. I'll delete it. If I don't delete it, it will keep on calculating the price. Okay, so but in organization level you need not worry, because there will be a tie up between Amazon and organization. But if I use KSR is not tied up with AWS, they will charge more. I'm telling you, right, 2 years back, 3 years back, I was reaching around 60,000-70,000 bill. Now slowly we are optimizing. We know, got to know where it is costing. We have not tied up, so that's the reason they will cost you more. Even for this, whatever I showed for the last 5-10 minutes, you could have charged us 3,000 to 4,000. Just 5-10 minutes I used, right, you would have taken. And when you're building a model and all, the same model when I show it in the notebook, it will even cost you 10,000-15,000. Let's see if it's still deleting. Okay, there are no resources deleted. Again, you can go and again you can create a create notebook instance. Again, it will create. Okay, but now it's not required. Now I have to go delete the data also, or else this also they will charge. They have put some restrictions on all. Directly, I cannot delete. I have to write this permanently deleted everything. To confirm deletion, type permanently deleted in the text box. Some type of security they are giving. Now if you go and see SageMaker, nothing is there. Notebook instance, nothing is there. Okay. Now I'll go to S3 bucket. S3 bucket also, this bucket is there. This bucket also I will delete it. Deleting a bucket cannot be undone. Bucket names are unique. If you delete a bucket, another AWS can use the same bucket. Okay. So what is my bucket name? KSR training AWS. Delete the bucket now. Bucket also deleted. Now again, you can go create a bucket, upload new data, and using the SageMaker Jupyter Notebook, start coding. Okay, so whatever I've done in my personal system, the same thing you can do it on my cloud-based, but it's a chargeable. You need not have a software install, you need not have a Python, you don't have an Anaconda, you no need anything. Just they will only create everything for you. Okay, so this is about the AWS SageMaker S3 bucket running a Jupyter Notebook and running a code. Directly, I will be accessing path of the S3 bucket. Is it clear? Any questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that's all for today. If you have any questions, reach out to me. We'll meet again next week with a new topic.